Hi, I'm Phil Constantine, and this is Travels with Phil. And on this episode, we're going to Pennsylvania to find out, did George Washington single-handedly start the French and Indian War, or the Seven Years' War? So first, let's take a look at what we're talking about. Let's go over to Pennsylvania. That's the area you see being drawn in around the map, and we're going to a particular spot in the southwestern section of Pennsylvania. So let's zoom in and see what's happening there. Now, wait, first, let's go back and set the stage for this event. So let's take a look at what the North American continent, particularly the United States and Canada, looked like before this incident happened. This is the United States, or what it is now. There's Canada up here, Mexico down to the south. Well, this area here that you see in sort of the salmon or pink color, this was all claimed and pretty well acknowledged to be the area under the jurisdiction of Britain, or United Kingdom. And all the blue here was claimed and reasonably well accepted as property that was under the influence of France. Well, you notice that this part of Pennsylvania, where we're talking about here, has British up to a certain point and French up to a certain point. The spot you see here, Fort Duquesne's, that's now Pittsburgh, and that's where the scene or the focal point of a lot of this activity took place. So let's go back to that satellite view and come in once again here to this part of Pennsylvania. And the place we're going to is called Fort Necessity. It's part of a national park. And George Washington was out here working on the road that you see up there in the map, going from Alexandria over to Fort Duquesne's, or what is now called Pittsburgh. So what we're going to do is we're going to look at the history that put George Washington here, the British versus the French, and started an international war.
This event here changed the world. There are great places that we visit that are monumental to American history. Jumonville Glen is one of those. We often don't see it that way. We look at places like Independence Hall, or maybe standing where Pickett's Charge occurred, or other sites in history dealing with the civil rights movement. But right here in 1754, the world did dramatically change. The British would go on to be victorious in their war against France, a global war. France, seeking revenge, would help an upstart rebellion we know as the American Revolution. And ultimately, that would lead France to its demise as a monarchy with its revolution and the rise of Napoleon. And Napoleon, well, he needed money. He thought those Americans would be dumb enough to purchase the land that we know as Louisiana Purchase.
To help explain everything that's going on, let's go to National Park Service Ranger Brian Reedy, who will give you a lot of background.
In 1754, we have three cultures that are coming into conflict here in the Ohio River Valley. That's where this National Park Service site sits. We're about 60 miles south of Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, in Fayette County, Pennsylvania. We're not very far from the West Virginia line. But in 1754, according to the British, this was considered Virginia. According to the French, coming down from Canada, this was part of New France. And we have American Indians who've been living in this area for nearly 10,000 years. So when three groups want the same thing, there's bound to be a conflict. For the British, they have a little tougher assignment getting to this area. They have to build roads. There are no navigable rivers through the Allegheny Mountains. And that's why a young Virginian named George Washington was given that assignment in the spring of 1754 to build a military supply road to the forks of the Ohio, or what today we call Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. That was considered a very strategic point to be. That's what the British were hoping to build a fort, and they needed to have that road to get to that fort. Unfortunately for the British, the French would win out in that race and build a much larger fort there called Fort Duquesne. Washington, who was aware of that, still decided to build that road for future operations. And during the process of building the road, he comes to this area that we're standing in right now. This is called the Great Meadows. This is a natural clearing that's been here for thousands and thousands of years. So what Washington walked into on the 24th of May, 1754, was a meadow that was about a mile long. Began out by our park entrance over here to the east and kind of swept through here, gradually widening to about 200 yards, and then would eventually head towards the north and the west, where it would begin to narrow again. So think of it as a big crescent-shaped meadow. And in the midst of this meadow is where Washington would camp.
Now let's go over to Jumonville Glen with Ranger Josh Freeman for additional information and some background info.
The Ohio Valley in 1754 is a tinderbox. There are a number of factors and a number of reasons that conflict, to a certain extent, is inevitable. And both Britain and France had decided to send armed military forces into the Ohio Valley in the spring of 1754 with the exact same mission. And generally, when you put two armed bodies of men in close proximity, perhaps even though you may not be in open conflict, Britain and France are not at war in the spring of 1754, but when you put those two armed bodies of men in close proximity, something bad can generally happen. And that bad thing, really a world-changing event, is going to occur right here where we are at Jumonville Glen on the morning of May 28th, 1754. So why did Washington come here and really, you know, attack the French? I know oftentimes in his histories we see that it was sort of a he said, she said, we don't know. You know, the British blame the French blame the British. If you pay close attention to the historical record and really some new historical sources that have come to light in the last couple of years, I think it's pretty clear that Washington came here with the intent of attacking a small French party encamped here in Jumonville Glen. So why would he do that? Why, from the British perspective, would they attack the French, even though there's no open conflict? Well, to Washington, in his mind, the French had already sort of been, they had been the hostile aggressors. They had been acting in a menacing, hostile manner throughout the spring of 1754. You know, the British had sent a small force to the forks of the Ohio, modern-day Pittsburgh, to build a fort in the middle of March and April. The British are there building their fort on April 17th when the French arrive in force. And although there are no shots fired on that day in April, the French really evict the British at gunpoint. They leave them no choice. They point guns at them, say, you either leave or we're going to destroy you. And a small little British party is forced to leave and go back to Virginia. And so in Washington's mind, as he's advancing from Virginia up here trying to build a road, his mission had been to build a road and help those soldiers, Virginia soldiers down there at the forks of the Ohio, to build a fort. That is sort of, you know, the French acting hostile. They had showed up, pointed guns at the British, and told them they had to leave. So they had already committed a hostile act. Washington's instructions from Governor Dinwiddie had told him that if anybody had sort of stood in his way, no matter who it was, like he was specifically referencing the French, but then when he says, if anyone impedes your progress or tries to prevent you from doing your mission, you are authorized to attack them. Dinwiddie tells him he can, you know, kill or destroy any enemies that try to prevent him from doing that. So Washington, to a certain extent, has authorization to act the way he does. He's seen this hostile intent from the French. And in the lead up to this event, as Washington is getting closer and closer to Chestnut Ridge, at the end of May, he arrives at the Great Meadows on May 24th, 1754. The Great Meadows, the site of Fort Necessity, about 7 miles from here. As he arrives there on May 24th, he also gets word from his Native American allies, from the Half King, who is his main American Indian ally. And the Half King actually sends him word that a large French party had left Fort Duquesne with the intent of destroying the first English they came across. So Washington receives intelligence that he believes to be valid, that the Half King is trying to help him out, that a French party is out and they're going to attack him. And the Half King doesn't say how many, he just says a large French party. Washington, again, is at the Great Meadows from May 24th up until about May 27th, and he gets various reports of the French. But on May 27th, Christopher Gist, who is a very close ally of Washington, an Ohio Company trader who had been Washington's guide on several occasions, is going to arrive from his settlement just over the mountains near modern-day Mount Braddock, Pennsylvania. And Gist will tell Washington the French had been at his house the day before. They had been acting menacingly. They had threatened his property and some people that were there. They were going to destroy items. So the French are acting in a hostile manner. And Washington is also getting reports that the French, specifically one officer among them, a gentleman named LaForce, who is the French main interpreter, is really, to a certain extent, after the Half King and has threatened to kill the Half King. And so Washington looks at that as the French being the aggressors. They are acting in a hostile manner. And so on May 27th, after Gist's report and after receiving several intelligence reports from the Half King, by that evening, Washington is becoming alarmed. The French are coming after him. He doesn't know where they are. But in the evening, after dark, somewhere around 8 p.m. on May 27th, the half-king will send word by one of his warriors that the French are nearby. The half-king had been coming over the mountain to warn Washington, and they had discovered tracks of a French party that led down into what they called a gloomy, dark hollow. And so when Washington receives this report, he decides, well, he knows where the French are, and he's going to go leave the Great Meadows and come and deal with the threat. And so after dark, about 10 p.m. on May 27th, Washington will take about 40 men and leave the Great Meadows. And they will travel overnight all night. And Washington writes that it is a dark, gloomy night. He calls it a night as dark as pitch. It's raining throughout the night. And it'll really take them from about 10 p.m. on May 27th till about dawn on May 28th to travel from the Great Meadows to a place today known as Half King's Rocks. It was where the Half King had encamped. And about dawn, they meet the Half King. And Washington writes that they formulated a plan there at Half King's Rocks to strike the French. It says the Half King and I made a plan to strike the French. And so from that point, about a mile and a half from here, the Washington and his men and the Half King and his warriors formulated a plan. They leave the Half King's Rocks, headed this way. Washington says he sent out scouts. The Half King's and some of his warriors will scout out the position as well. And they've discovered the French in this glen right behind me, this sheer rock face where the French have encamped for several days. And so they've established a pretty significant camp. They have bark huts. And then Washington and the Half King made a pretty good plan to attack the French. We know, not just from Washington's accounts, but also from a Native American account that has been recently discovered, how the British and American Indian force dispersed themselves. So Washington's men would sort of move on the glen head-on from the direction behind the camera, basically straight forward to see the French down here. A small Native American force under a warrior named Monocatutha and another one will go around the side of the glen, off to my left, your right, to sort of seal off that side. And the Half King and his warriors will move beyond the rock face, basically north to the bottom of the glen to seal off that escape route. North would be most likely the French route of escape. And so the Half King and his warriors will move, and they'll have the French camp for the most part completely surrounded by about 7:30, 8 o'clock. We don't know specifically exactly what time this engagement started, but all the sources, the French and the British, agree on it's between 7 and 8 o'clock in the morning. So it is not in the dark of night. It's not really first thing at dawn. It has been daylight for a couple of hours. Some of the French are milling about. Some of them are making breakfast. Some of them are still asleep. But the British and the Native American force will have the French encampment here surrounded. Washington writes, and several other British and even French sources agree to a certain extent, that as the British soldiers, Washington's force, he has, about 40 men here, as they're moving into position, basically just behind you, they're moving forward in a single file line, what Washington calls Indian fashion, when Washington writes that a Frenchman would discover him, and that he is at the very front of the line, and our a Native American account that we'll talk about here in a little bit also agrees that Washington is in the very front. And many of you probably saw a Smithsonian article not that long ago by Dr. David Preston, where he talks in depth about how George Washington is most likely the very first person to fire the shot of this engagement. And again, Washington being at the very front of the line, the French see him, they run for their arms, and there's shots fired. But it does seem very likely that George Washington himself is the person that opens this engagement. Probably, again, moving towards this French encampment behind me, from just behind you off camera. The British would line up along the edge of this glen, the open sort of southern end of the glen, and would commence firing on the French. So the engagement happens very quickly, sort of by surprise. We often think of it as an ambush. It's not really an ambush in that, to a certain extent, the French discovered the British force. However, they just don't know that they're, at this point, basically completely surrounded by British soldiers and American Indian warriors. So, again, as the engagement opens up, the French are in their camp, and shots are fired. Again, most likely by George Washington, but the French will return fire.
So let's go over to Brian Reedy, and he'll give you a bit of a perspective from the British side here at Jumonville Glen.
The French became very aware that the British were heading to this area. Washington, as we know, was building a military road to supply British troops where the Forks of the Ohio, or present-day Pittsburgh, is. That force at the Forks of the Ohio were forced out. The French built Fort Duquesne. And from there, on the 23rd of May, a patrol of 35 French, led by Ensign Joseph Colon Dinwiddie Jumonville, is sent out to deliver a summons to the first English officer he encounters. He is also told in those same orders to reconnoiter, scout around. And I'm sure if he encounters a smaller force, maybe a trader on his own or a small settlement, that he would have the advantage to kind of bully them, to force them out. And we know that that force did arrive at the Gist plantation. That's about 7 miles from here, and did that a few days prior to the incident here in the Glen. Jumonville had decided to camp here, not too far from his road, that the trail, which is located several hundred yards in that direction. And the idea was to find a place out of the weather. So this escarpment here, which kind of follows along this valley, seemed to be a good location for that, and they would build bark lean-tos. So they were here for a few days. It was not just one night. There's a good source of water located over here to my right. So again, an ideal camp. Now, Washington, though, would see it differently. He would see that they were probably hiding here, maybe to attack him, surprise him in some way, perhaps assassinate the half-king. So each had their different reasons for camping here. So was Jumonville strictly here just to get out of the weather or to spy on those British and seek an advantage to maybe attack Washington? We'll never know. Unfortunately, one of those killed here is the commander, Jumonville. And it's left to his subordinates, a gentleman named Mercier, to talk about why they were here, that they were on a diplomatic mission. Who fired the first shot? Well, according to the French accounts, it's the British who fired two volleys. And Jumonville comes out to say, "I have something to read to you." And that account says that the British drew in close to listen. And as that summons was being read, the British fire a third volley, killing Jumonville and capturing the rest of the party. Fortunately for the French, according to their account, it's the Native Americans that saved them from being slaughtered by the British. So again, far different account than what Washington tells us. We also have an account of a Native American who, at a council in October of 1754, tells us that they did most of the damage. It's not the British. The British did fire a few shots, end up hitting one of their own men, wounding another Frenchman in the cheek, and it's the French, as they're running away, that when they encounter those Native Americans, actually get slaughtered, get butchered by the Native Americans, and the French come back here to eventually surrender to the British. So again, a 15-minute skirmish, lots of unanswered questions, but that's the intrigue of history. What really happened here?
After the skirmish at Jumonville, George Washington goes back over to the area of the Great Meadow, and Ranger Brian Reedy takes it up from there.
Now, Washington would build a supply base here, and it began with a very simple stockade and a cabin. Inside, Washington would build a 14 by 14 log cabin, and that cabin's purpose was quite simple. It protected the perishable supplies. So it was not an office for Washington, it was not a barracks for the men, it's simply a large closet to make sure the gunpowder, the rum, the cornmeal, the flour are all out of the elements. The yard that existed between the stockade and the cabin would have been filled with boxes and barrels, other supplies that didn't have to be stored in the cabin itself. So this really is not a place of refuge for the soldiers to fight from. What they would have fought from were the creek beds. Again, we're kind of in the widest part of that meadow, and part of that reason for choosing it, again, forces the enemy to come out to you, but there's also two stream banks. Behind the stockade, you can kind of see the high shrubs. That outlines what's called Great Meadows Run. That basically bisects this meadow. And then directly ahead of me is Indian Run. And they come together, about 60 yards in the direction I'm pointing. And Washington, when he first sets up camp here, says that with nature's assistance, he has been given natural entrenchments. So what he decided to have his men do, if they were to be attacked here, was to use those natural entrenchments. But again, he never anticipated having to fight here. He's camped here from the end of May to about mid-June. He receives reinforcements, and he actually would push westward, building his road. By the end of June, he gets word that the French are now coming after him because, well, the end of May, he had attacked a French patrol. That's known as the Jumonville Affair. And so the French are coming after him for revenge. He tries to get out of the area. This is all the further he would get in his retreat. And out of necessity, he ends up having to fight here. Now, his army has grown from the initial 150 that started out in early April to almost 400 troops. So these creek beds aren't going to be enough. So what he builds is what was referred to as breastworks. And we see the remnants of that. Fortunately, a good bit of the snow has melted since yesterday. There was about a good foot of snow here. But the grassy outline you see here kind of forms two V's, but formed together creates a big square. Those are where the breastworks would have been. Washington's men in the days prior to the battle would have been piling the logs up. And again, the stockade and cabin were built end of May, beginning of June, and a month later when he's back here, the men are hastily basically building a redoubt. This is the true part of the fort right here. And it faces those areas. You know, we have a nice long trench here and a nice long trench there because the tree lines come the closest in those two areas. Remember I told you the muskets had a limited range, about 60 to 80 yards effectively. Well, the tree line's about 60 yards on that side and 80 yards on that side. And again, if Washington had that crystal ball that told him he was going to have to fight here in July, he probably would have taken the time to clear the woods a little bit further back. Well, now it's too late. And on the morning of July 3rd, the French do appear at the far end of the meadow. Washington goes out to fight them in an open formation. The French take advantage of the tree lines and quickly surround Washington, and Washington and his men would fight from these trenches during 8 to 9 hours of rain. Heavy downpours, mist, fog, not the best conditions to fight in with the weapons of that time that tend to misfire. He also has very few bayonets to his defense. So he figures he's going to get wiped out. But by 8 o'clock in the evening, he is surprised from the French who call out to him to see if he wants to talk surrender. And he's a little suspicious, but he does take up their offer. And over the course of 3 to 4 hours, the French do negotiate what's considered an honorable surrender during a time when there is no declared war. It basically allows Washington to leave here with all his baggage. His men can keep their muskets. All they do is clear out of this area and not return here for a year. But it also says in that document that Washington is responsible for the assassination of a French diplomat. So it gives the French justification to show the world, basically propaganda, that they were justified in their attack, their retribution against Washington.
So to sum it all up, on May 28, 1754, George Washington fires the very first shot in a skirmish between the British and the French at Jumonville Glen. A month later at Fort Necessity, the French return and they defeat George Washington and the British troops, and he surrenders for the only time in his military career, oddly enough, on July 4th, and he is branded an assassin. Well, the British retaliate, and this leads to the French and Indian War, which becomes the Seven Years' War internationally. Eventually, the British win, and the French lose a vast majority of their empire in North America. Well, to pay for the war, the British charge taxes on the United States. The United States rebels. That leads to the American Revolution. The French, to get some retaliation against the British, help the Americans. And then eventually the American freedom leads to the downfall of the French monarchy and the French Revolution, which leads to Napoleon. And eventually Napoleon runs out of money and sells the Louisiana Purchase to the dumb Americans. So this one little fight from George Washington led to a whole world of change. Thank you very much for watching this video. Please feel free to make comments below as long as the language is family friendly. And if you like this video, please click on the thumbs up button below. You can also subscribe to my YouTube channel by clicking on the circle with my picture in it in the lower right hand corner of the video. The arrow is pointing at it now. And once you have subscribed, you can be notified of when I have a new video posted by clicking on the bell icon in the description field below the video. Thanks again for watching.